Wallace Ford, and welcome to the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition. Remember, the Inclusion Show is the only show that includes you. And our guest today is attorney Neville Mitchell. Neville Mitchell is a criminal defense lawyer here in New York City with an outstanding career in that field. And he's here to talk about his professional experiences as a criminal defense lawyer, and as well to comment generally on an issue that's really been in the news over the last couple of years. It's always been important, but it's taken on a higher level of attention these days, and of course that's the entire criminal justice system and law enforcement. So with that, Neville Mitchell, welcome to the Inclusion Show, brother.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
All right, good to see you. Now, wanted to at least make sure that our viewers have a perspective on just who Neville Mitchell is. And you and I have known each other for quite a while, and so true. But I won't give all of this away. You can talk about it a little bit. Just how'd you get into the practice of law in the first place?
I think I decided I wanted to be a lawyer, and I always knew I would be a criminal defense lawyer. In late high school, college.
Mm-hmm. Now you were in high school at Bronx Science, right?
Right. And then I stayed in the city. I went to City College and mm-hmm. all the way to Baltimore, University mm-hmm. of Maryland Law School.
Okay.
As distinct from the University of Baltimore, which is that law school, is that other school.
Okay.
Then I came back, mm-hmm. To New York. So I think my inspiration really to become a lawyer is just that I was always interested in, I don't want to use the word downtrodden, but people who didn't get a fair shake. Uh-huh. And I sort of always felt, not having done any empirical study, but just from anecdotal information, that the system was unfair. Mm-hmm. I felt that. And so I came out, I worked for the city for maybe 2 or 3 years in the Department of Housing. Preservation and development. And then right after that, I came out and hung out my shingle and took a severance package, hung out my shingle, and been on my own ever since.
Well, let me ask you a question just about that focus on criminal defense work, mm-hmm. Which, you know, and I was in law school as well, and I know that a number of people say, well, you know, one of the things about being a criminal defense lawyer is that most of the people you meet are guilty. And so, you know, they did something, and so therefore, they don't necessarily want to get engaged in that level of practice. You speak, you know, so some people decide to become prosecutors, other people they just go on the civil side. But you speak about this notion that people just didn't get a fair shake,
right?
And so you've had numerous cases since you became an attorney here in New York. Can you just give us some examples of how that particular perspective that you bring to this very day to your work, how that really was illustrated?
You mean in terms of not getting a fair shake?
Yeah,
you
know, clients that were but for
right.
These people wouldn't have gotten a fair shake. How does that play out?
It is not totally wrong that majority, I won't say 90% or anything like that, of the people mm-hmm. in the criminal justice system are guilty. Mm-hmm. It's also not wrong that they might have committed some crime at some point. The important thing for me and my colleagues that I know and work with has always been that everybody is entitled to a defense. Even the person charged with the most heinous crime, I believe, is entitled to a defense, because the state, the government, has all these resources, and sometimes it's just this one person, and you better have a good lawyer, because there are rules to the game, and your lawyer better know the rules.
To that point, of course, that there is this slight detail that every person is presumed innocent.
Correct.
Until proven guilty.
Correct.
Right? And that seems to have kind of gone past the board, like arrest equals guilt, in certainly in the media these days, right?
That's certainly true, because mm-hmm. everything is sensationalized. But if you take it even further, where there's really an issue in the criminal justice system with regard to just an arrest being tantamount to being guilty, mm-hmm. when you have to say face a picking a jury selection, and doing voir dire and asking people, who they support, asking people what they feel about the system, asking people about who's the defendant. I mean, I had a situation where I was picked out as a defendant at a defense table.
You were picked out as
the defendant. Yeah.
Okay. I hope you had somebody to vouch for you.
Well, yeah, that's totally other story, right? But no, so you have to also overcome that.
Sure.
This, when you think it's really a presumption of innocence, mm-hmm. That's just.
It's more like a presumption of guilt, isn't it?
I don't know if I'll go that far to mm-hmm. say, but it's very, very difficult to overcome the average person coming in off the street, sitting in that jury box, and seeing somebody sitting at the defense table, and you trying to explain that person is presumed innocent. Mm-hmm. And the judge has to explain that, you know, this is just an indictment. It doesn't mean that the person did anything, and so on.
And they don't have to prove that they're innocent.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. So those issues always come up, and it's always very difficult to get
people. Well, so we can't discuss all of this without bringing the issue of race in this country, because so many, there's a disproportionate number of African Americans who are subject to the criminal justice system, either being arrested or going on trial or, of course, being sentenced to prison. In comparison to our part in the population. And so it's one of the things that, and we're going to take a break in a moment, but I just in terms of that presumption of guilt that I just alluded to, because and there's been all of these various psychological studies and surveys where people associate African Americans with some level of criminality, particularly male African Americans. Right. And if you're sitting there, you know, in handcuffs with an orange jumpsuit, and here you were in a bow tie and suit, and people still thought you were the defendant, right?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, how do you overcome that presumption?
Very, very difficult mm-hmm. to overcome that. Mm-hmm. But we can't just see it. Some people see it as an isolated thing where you're dealing with a jury pool that might feel a certain way mm-hmm. about African Americans. Mm-hmm. But you also have to deal a lot of times with judges that have these same sort of inclinations,
predispositions,
exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Prosecutors that have those same kind, to use your word, mm-hmm. Predispositions. Mm-hmm. So it's the whole system. Mm-hmm. And when people talk a lot about the system being unfair, the system is run by people, mm-hmm. and the people come into that system just like police officers. Whatever they come to the to the table with, that's mm-hmm. who they are.
Okay. I want you to hold that thought there, Neville, because I want to come back and we're going to talk about that and the latest U.S. Department of Justice report regarding Ferguson. This is the Inclusion Show, Weekend Edition. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Inclusion Show, Weekend Edition. Our guest is attorney Neville Mitchell, and Neville, criminal defense lawyer here in New York City. And Neville, just before the break, we were talking about this notion of presumption of guilt as is applied to African Americans. Right. And just to be clear, we were talking about this off camera for a moment, it's not just white Americans that have this presumption of guilt directed towards African Americans in the criminal justice system, is it?
Absolutely not.
Okay, your experience, does it apply to African Americans?
I will tell you, it's everybody that's susceptible to all of the things that are put out by the media.
Well, or the imagery, between
imagery,
the movies
and
the gangster,
exactly.
Persona and all of that stuff, I guess.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, it's African Americans, it's Asians, it's Africans, it's Indians, it's whoever can be influenced by that. I've had times when I'm picking a jury and I exclude certain people, and somebody might say to me, why did you kick that person off? They're black. Mm-hmm. And you don't want to say that, not the right type of black, but mm-hmm. you're trying to figure out
right.
what people are thinking
yeah.
and what their tendencies are. Mm-hmm. So everybody's susceptible to that.
Okay. Well, that's that kind of takes us to a segue with the U.S. Department of Justice about a week or so ago came out with this report regarding just the racial and racially biased and racist activity by the police department in Ferguson, Missouri, which of course was the scene of the shooting of Michael Brown last year, and there's been all of this turmoil going on. What's your take on the DOJ report? I mean, it's obviously, it says some pretty tough things about how business is done in Ferguson, but is Ferguson an outlier? Is that an anomaly?
I don't think Ferguson is an anomaly. I think there are many Fergusons around around this country. I think you can have Ferguson, New York. I think we should look at the bail policies of New York City and what percentage of that money New York City gets when they put that money in the bank. I mean, mm-hmm. we can do different kinds of analysis. Mm-hmm. I think the report done by the Justice Department was very thorough. I think I certainly believe that they should take over. They should disband or take over either one. The Ferguson Police Department. I think that their findings with regard to what the judge was doing, or the judge who resigned, police chief who resigned, the city manager who resigned.
All kinds of people resigned.
Exactly.
Now.
Exactly.
But let me ask you this, Neville. If Ferguson is not the outlier that some people would make it out to be, it's terrible what they're doing in Ferguson. Mm. But here we are in New York, Chicago, Philadelphia, Miami, right. wherever, and we're not that bad. If it's not the outlier, and your approach is that, well, maybe we should just disband or take over the police department. What do we do with these other police departments? We have 35,000 right. police in New York City. You can't right. disband that police right. department, right?
So you can't.
No.
So the problem is systemic. But most people think and talk about a change in training. Mm-hmm. And
yeah, what does that mean
that,
to you?
That to me, when somebody comes to the police department and they behave a certain way, I think it's very hard to untrain that. Mm-hmm. And you know, if somebody has racist feelings, I don't think you can untrain that. So before people come into the department, they have to do a more, I would say, a more thorough investigation into those folks. A lot of the folks that come into the department because they've always wanted to, exert force against others and that kind of stuff. So I think it's very hard to untrain things.
But again, Neville, you know, we just talked before about predispositions that right. people have because of the media images. Jesse Jackson famously said, about 10, 15 years ago, that when he goes into an ATM at night, he hates to say it, but if he goes into an ATM at night and three young black men come in behind him, he's scared, or he's concerned at that point for his own safety. And there's all kinds of anecdotal stories and actual accounts that where people just, if they see African Americans, they think that there's going to be some criminal activity involved, right. whether it actually happens or not. Witness stop and frisk, okay,
right.
and so on. So how do you deal with that predisposition, which sounds like an American issue? It's not just a police issue,
right.
is it? I mean, this is a virus in the United States bloodstream. So what if training doesn't do it? You will accept that we need police, right? Nobody wants to do away with this.
Absolutely accept that.
Yeah. So what do we do?
I would agree with you wholeheartedly that it's not simply a police issue.
Okay.
Racism is endemic mm-hmm. in American society, and it goes on and on from generation to generation. Unless we have systems in place that's going to root that out, unless we change the way African Americans are dealt with in this society, and the projection, how people are projected, right? And some of it is, quite frankly, is just going to be time. I mean, people don't want to hear that. But some of it is just going to be time. I think some of the younger kids now, like what happened with Michael Brown, or what happened with Eric Garner, when you looked out and you saw the people who were in the streets. I saw people from all kinds of faiths, backgrounds, colors, and I'm mm-hmm. heartened to see young people.
Mm-hmm.
So some of that is just time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, time to get past some, and it's difficult mm-hmm. Because the problems are here now, and you want to solve them now, but some of them you can't solve right away. You can just do your best.
Well, we're going to, again, have to take a break in a moment. But before we do, I just want to put this thought out here, and we can mm-hmm. and take it up from there, which I just hate to circle back to this. But if indeed it's an issue, whether we see it in Ferguson or whether we see it at the University of Oklahoma,
right.
okay, where the SAE had these nigger chants or whatever,
right.
if anybody thinks that's the only college or university in America where that's happening, then
right.
They just came in from another planet. Right. But just the other day, one of the announcers on, I think it was Univision, he referred to Michelle Obama as someone she looks like she came from the planet of the apes, right? So he got fired for that.
Right.
But it's like, okay, where does that thinking right. even come into? This is 2015, for goodness sake. So I'm not asking you to have all the answers at the moment because we're going to take a break.
Right.
But when we come back, perhaps we could take a moment to talk about just how can we move forward with respect to the criminal justice system and this very real issue that we're dealing with.
Okay.
This is The Inclusion Show. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Inclusion Show. I'm your host, Wallace Ford. Our guest, Attorney Neville Mitchell, criminal defense attorney here in New York City. And Neville, just before the break, we were talking about this whole issue of race and law enforcement and the criminal justice system. But let's just double back for a moment, because that discussion emanated from or arose out of our thinking about this U.S. Department of Justice report on Ferguson. What else did you get out of the report other than Ferguson's not a nice place for black people?
I think one of the important things about the report is the focus on the police stopping people just to generate revenue. A lot of that was going on, and that there was a policy in place to try to get more and more money, and that
overcharging people, double charging people,
sending out warrants, locking people up. That's some really extreme examples. But what I wanted to say about Ferguson is, at some level, when we have the ability to be autonomous and have people in office that reflect us, we should do that. And I think that's an issue. That's a real issue in Ferguson, that they have enough citizens there. That if they wanted to have a
67%,
exactly. Yeah. If they wanted to have a black city council, all black, they could do that. And so there's some other issues going on there besides the numbers and lack of participation. Why is the voting numbers, the percentage of the population, so low? And there might be some historical thing about that, but those issues have to be dealt with.
Okay, because you know, I've heard the discussion that goes to juries, as well. The jury pool is based on the voting rolls, and if you're not registered to vote, you're not going to get selected for jury. Some people have argued that, for example, with respect to why do you need to register to vote in order to be eligible to be in a jury? I mean, being on a jury is a duty of citizenship. Should that be conditioned by whether you're registered to vote in the political process? And what do you think?
It should not, but that's not always true. It's a question of where they pull the rolls from. Some places it's driver's license. They got to figure out where people are, right? But it's important that you just mentioned being on juries, right? One of the things that was very upsetting to the people in Ferguson, all around the nation, was the grand jury.
Sure. Right?
If you're not in the jury pool.
Right, you're not going to be a grand jury.
So it's all those things that are very important. You got to participate in the process. Yes, we understand the process is not fair. I go as far as to say the process is racist because of people in it. And so you can't just fire this one person. You got to deal with everybody in the process, right? But you must always participate. You can't stand on the side and just kind of like throw stones, right? You got to get in there, and it's going to get nasty and difficult and grimy, but you got to go in there swinging.
No. Well, so when we see these, again, going back to what we talked about at the outset in terms of making sure that people get a, quote, fair shot, okay, given what we're talking about in terms of just the statistical analysis of the U.S. justice system right now, African Americans make up 13% of the population, we're 60% of the prison population. This country has 2.5 million people in prison, more than any other country in the world. The list kind of goes on. We have 50,000 people serving life sentences. They have the best lawyer in town representing them. How does that fair shake happen?
You mean as an individual if you're in court?
Yeah.
Your lawyer has to be prepared to deal with the system as it is. Your lawyer cannot go in there blind and thinking it's a bed of roses. Your lawyer has to understand that you might be faced with a judge who has certain propensities. You might be faced with a
But you still have to deal with him or her.
You do. But you're in that room to make sure your client gets the best defense. A quick example. I'm trying a case. They're playing a tape of a 911 call about an incident. And on the tape, the person who is calling into the police says something about, it was a shooting, so said something about gorillas in the mist, right? And the prosecutor starts laughing. So I asked the judge to clear the court, and he does. And I asked for an explanation as to why you were laughing at that, right? And the judge looked at me and looked at him and said, can you explain why you were laughing at a reference to gorillas? There were two other counsels next to me. They didn't look like me. All the defendants were black, but they weren't going to raise that point.
Right.
I raised that point because I know that prosecutor laughing said something about his case, and also the jury might have seen him laughing.
Right.
So you always have to be...
And certainly his attitude. Yeah,
exactly. So you always have to pick up on what's going on. And that's, you just have to get an attorney, and I'm not saying the attorney has to be, you know, a black attorney, but it's got to be somebody who understands the system, one, and is not afraid to go against the things that are unfair. Mm-hmm. If I can give you one more quick example.
Sure.
You know about, suppression hearings,
sure.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And you know about stop and frisk, and mm-hmm. you know about what is the standard for searching people, right, and stopping people. Mm-hmm. One of the criteria that I always fight about and with judges and rail about is you stop people because they can be stopped. One factor, because they're in a high crime neighborhood. Mm-hmm. I'm like, so what does that mean? Does that mean that every innocent person that lives in a high crime neighborhood, anybody at all, can be stopped simply because you're in a mm-hmm. high crime neighborhood? And you have judges that are making these decisions that stop was proper. Mm-hmm. Stop was improper.
So that perpetuates
right, exactly. The, yeah, exactly. This problem. But you have to be prepared to argue and fight about those issues. So you can't accept that.
Well, there's no doubt, Neville, that you have been more than just arguing, that you've been fighting and fighting successfully to see that people get a fair shake. And certainly I want to just express my appreciation of your commitment to justice and with a big J, not a little J. And I want to right now extend an invitation for you to come back on the program, because this issue is not going anywhere. It continues to be important, and we appreciate your service, certainly, in that regard. So thanks so much for being on the show, man.
My pleasure.
Really
thanks,
appreciate it. Neville Mitchell, criminal defense attorney here in New York City. Thanks so much for coming on the show. Now it's time for From the Heart. And the title of our discussion right now has to do with the Negro problem and the letter. And over 150 years ago, Frederick Douglass, eloquent spokesperson for abolition and then thereafter for the rights of African Americans, said there really isn't a Negro problem in this country. What there is a problem with whether Americans are going to be loyal to their Constitution, whether they have the courage and the willingness to observe the laws of their own country. And so here we have 47 United States senators who decide that they're going to just abrogate the Constitution of the United States, which has a clear separation of powers between the President and the Congress, and send a letter to Iran, of all places, basically trying to undercut the President, disrespect him, and certainly show that he has no influence in this government in the United States. This has just literally never happened before. And you have to say, what is the source of that disrespect? Is it a problem that President Obama has? Is Israel so important? Is Iran so important? Is Iran's nuclear program, a possibility of it, so important? Or is it just a matter of the fact that these 47 U.S. senators represent and illustrate the level of disrespect that's racially based, that's been directed against this President of the United States since 2009? This has been the Inclusion Show, Weekend Edition. I'm your host, Wallace Ford. Stay strong and be great. We'll be right back.